And the scripture reading will be by Mike at John 18 to 39 to John 19, 7. And today we're going to look at what costly grace is, that Jesus is costly grace, that he paid the price fully, and we're going to look at that through the inspired word of John today. So we'll have Mike to do the scripture reading.
But you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews? They cried out again, Not this man, but Barabbas. Now Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews, and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him. So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, Behold the man. When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, Crucify him! Crucify him! Pilate said to them, Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him. The Jews answered him, We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has made himself the Son of God. These are the words of the living God.
Thank you,
Jesus, for your inspired word.
We are going to continue in the book of John. And so this is this short passage of scripture tells us a lot about what Jesus did for us. And in this short passage of scripture, we see how governments supported by religion is a really lethal mix. When religion puts its hope in human governments to resolve our problems as being the ultimate savior, then major problems follow. And that has been the trend in history. That has been the trend from generation to generation. And so what we see in the case of the crucifixion of Jesus is not the empowering of the world governments, but in fact, Jesus submitting himself to our human conditions to the point of death so that we could have life. And we realize as well as we look at those facts that when religion and government get together, it's an awful mix. It's a lethal mix because we know who is behind that. The book of Revelation tells us that it's Satan the devil who's behind that very clearly. The Apostle Paul tells us the same thing. And so you have a mixture of good and bad, and you have a mixture of deception, of lies, of all kinds of things that happen, because human beings, what we do, there can be a bit of good in it, and there can be some good, and there's always some bad accompanying it, because we choose for ourselves, apart from God, what is good and what is evil. So we make up rules as we go, if you will. So, but Jesus came to the earth. He came voluntarily. He was not forced to. And so he died for us that we could have, that we could be liberated from the ultimate consequence of sin, which is death. Now, this is the most important mission because that is what weighs humanity down, really, when you stop and think about it. And humanity is restless. And Augustine said, or one of them, I think it's Augustine, he said that we only find rest when we find our rest in God. And so humanity is restless, and God permits that because it's a consequence of our estrangements from God. And God but we are made for God. So when we get restless, we can look at all the other places, but the only place of rest is in Christ. There's no other place. And that's why even as we see what's going on around us, we can have peace because we trust in Christ, who is our peace. And we can be thankful for what he has done for us because he's won the ultimate victory for us. And it's costly grace. It's very costly grace because Jesus gave his life. He gave himself for us. And as we think about this, we always need to remember that God is Trinity in unity and unity in Trinity. So how Jesus acted towards us, what he did for us, is a reflection of the love of the one God for us. That is always very important to remember that, you know, God is for us. God will never change. And even if we don't know that as human beings, generally speaking, when we're blinded, it doesn't change the fact that's what God is. That's who God is. He's love and he's included us in himself. Now, as a human race, we can be very treacherous to one another. We fear one another. We divide in groups against one another. We are basically inward looking as people. And when we fear for our own well-being, what do? Well, thinking that we can find peace within ourselves, then we try to get the other group or the other people to think like we do. And if they don't, then we try to subjugate them or get rid of them. That's how we act, and that's how we acted towards Jesus Christ as human beings. You know, as human beings, we can have relative peace for a short time. And during our lives in North America, really, during the last 60, 70 years, well, since the end of the Second World War, in our territory, we haven't had any wars that our children were forced to go fight or that we were forced to go fight. And that is a blessing, but it's, you know, when you look at the history of this whole world, there's a window, and even in the 20th century, it was known as the bloodiest century from the onset of time because of wars and treacheries all over the world. And because that's how we cannot obtain final peace on our own. Somebody has to intervene on our behalf to give us peace. And the one who gives us peace, God tells us, is Jesus Christ. God with us. He's the only one. He came to this world not to create walls, but actually he came to this world to break down walls between people, between the Gentiles and between the Jews at the time, he said, and between all people, because in Christ, race doesn't matter, language doesn't matter, because his love is for all, and his future that he has reserved for us is fantastic, and it's for all people. That's his desire for all of us. So Jesus did that. What Jesus did is actually it's not like human beings things, because human beings, we want to take power, and we have the view of power that if we win over the other person by force, then we win and we can have peace somehow. But Jesus, what he did, he won over the power of sin by completely submitting to the consequences of it. He took our humanity upon himself came down to earth, and this is the great creator God who humbled himself, came one of us, and instead of fighting what was going on, he submitted to it. He submitted to it because he had absolutely no sin within himself, and death had no hold. And when he died and he was buried and he was laid behind the tomb, he was not going to stay there because he had no sin. So he won over sin. He won over sin and death and over all the opposition, and he conquered it by his resurrection. And so as we look at Jesus, we need to remember that he represents all of us. I found it interesting in Mr. Takaj's last weekly update, you know, that he asked the question, is there somebody living outside our earth? Is there any human beings, any human life beyond earth? And actually there is. There is Jesus Christ who lives in the heavenly, and he is the perfect man representing all of us, perfectly God, perfectly man, representing all of us. So there's actually life, human life, outside the sphere of this planet, when you think of it, in Christ. And Jesus, everyone is dependent on him, because the Apostle Paul tells us in Acts 17:28 that we all have our being in him. Whether we know it or not, whether we're opposed to him or not, everyone has his being in him. If for one nanosecond Jesus would say, I'm not sustaining the universe anymore, that would be the end of us. But that's not, God is faithful, and he's not like a man, and he doesn't get discouraged. He's going to do what he's going to do, and he sustains us, every one of us. Now, Jesus, when he came to the earth, he came as a very humble human being. He was born in the lowest of circumstances. He was miraculously conceived by the Holy Spirit in a virgin engaged to be married. So he accepted to be perceived as an illegitimate, a child who was illegitimate in our modern world, in our modern day world, as a bastard. And he accepted to have half-brothers. Last night we were looking at a history movie from Mexico, and there was the story of a nun, of a young girl who went into, became a nun, and became with the Trappist, actually, the Trappistin, we call them in French, the cloistered nuns. And she was forced to go in there. But what happens, the religious authority really went against her because her father and mother were not married. The father of the child was a religious man, and the mother was a concubine. So they turned against her because of it. Very unforgiving. And yet, Jesus took on that very identity, and he was accused of it, wasn't he? At the end of his life, he was accused because of how he was born. But he took all of this voluntarily for us. So when we stop and to think about what Jesus thinks, we must think about this amazing sacrificial love, that Jesus is the Lamb of God who took away the sin of the world. And he did it in love, in powerlessness. He took on our powerlessness to give us life and to free us to serve him, to serve God. There is no greater news than this, because if God had not intervened on our behalf, we would have absolutely no hope. We would have reasons to be restless. But we don't need to be restless because of what Jesus did for us. So, as we look at this, Pilate really had made a great effort to liberate Jesus. He basically said to the Jews, "You take him. Judge him by your law." The Jews said, "We are not allowed to kill anyone." So Pilate could not find anything to justify the death of Jesus Christ. And so he tried to appeal to their senses. He gave them a choice that he thought they would not refuse. You know, this is, maybe Pilate thought, this is stupid. I'm going to give them a man whom I'm sure they will reject, because Pilate did not want Jesus to be killed. He did not see any reason. He saw that Jesus was guiltless. In fact, at the end, he washed his hands. So he gave them an alternative. He said, "You know, you can choose between Jesus and Barabbas. And so he thought, you know, they will not let this criminal go. They will choose Jesus because Jesus has been very good to them. When you look at it from a human point of view, he fed the thousands. He encouraged people to turn to God. He healed innumerable people. He resurrected people. He was a very kind man." So Pilate presented Barabbas, who was a robber and a thief. The Bible tells us. We read that in Luke 23:19, that he was also a murderer, a killer. He was a brutal man. He was put in prison because he had caused an insurrection. So what did the people do? The people chose him. Now, who was responsible? Who was behind the frenzy of the crowd? Well, it was the religious establishment. Because Caiaphas had said in Matthew 20, says, "Now the chief priest and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas to destroy Jesus." Those are strong words, isn't it? They wanted to destroy Jesus. And they convinced the crowd, and you know, when a crowd is on a frenzy, people don't think, they just follow. And as human beings, you know, we're compared to sheep. And if we have a shepherd that leads us the wrong way, then we have a tendency, we follow him. When our real shepherd is Jesus Christ, we are to look to him. So they wanted to destroy Jesus. That's the word that the Apostle John is using. And Jesus accepted that, because that's why he came on the earth, to be destroyed by us, to allow that his life would be taken. And the Jews were very nationalistic. You know, they did not want anyone to share. They thought they were it, and they were to be the dominant people. And they had this fervor, and when people have this fervor of nationalism, then you have problems. So, and their nationalistic fervor was even more fervent around the time of Passover. I like what Mr. Ted Johnson said. He's a pastor in GCI, senior pastor. He said, "Perhaps many in the crowd admired Barabbas for his cunning courage and rejoiced that he was fighting Rome. Had they honestly compared and contrasted the two candidates, they would have voted for Jesus. But when a mob is manipulated by crafty leaders, in an atmosphere of patriotic fervor, it loses itself and starts to think with its feeling instead of its brains. Their condemning vote said nothing about the Son of God, but it said a great deal about them. And as we read this, we have to remember that Jesus submitted himself to this malicious behavior. He accepted that. It's the Lamb of God. So Caiaphas was behind all of that, the high priest that year. He had said that one man should die for the people, and of course, that was all prophesied before. What Jesus went through was all prophesied before. It was determined that he would die. So the high priest and his court, if you will, pressured Pilate into giving in. When Jesus appeared before them, there was nothing he could say. He was already a condemned man. It was really an illegal trial, if you will. They just wanted to get rid of him. They told, at that time, and as human beings, it shows the fickleness of human beings and how to reach our own end. We can just change our minds and just change our coats like that. Because the religious establishment and the feverish crowd, if you will, said, we only have one king, and that king is Caesar. In John 19:15, we can read about that. So, in fact, what happened is that Adam and Eve rejected God in the Garden of Eden, and mankind rejected God another time when Christ was crucified. We said, we don't want you as king. We want our human kings. And Jesus, in his love, lets us make our decision. We're not robots. He just doesn't force anybody. But when we look at all the prophecies, both in the Old and the New Testament, we see nations coming in and worshiping Jesus, worshiping God, nations, multitudes, because that restlessness is going to drive us to God. God is, the Holy Spirit is, will use that restlessness to say, you know, your way doesn't work. Trust me. So Jesus submitted to all of that for all of us out of love and for all generations. That is the encouraging good news. So Jesus submitted to the savagery and the violence of human beings. The Bible history says Jesus was scourged and tortured with leather whip, his crown of thorns, the crown of fallen humanity, placed on his head, was an awful symbol showing man's complete contempt for all that God loves and values. It was also an emblematic of our Savior's love for all of us and our minds, which are deceived and pained by so much of this world's lies. Perhaps it's also a vicarious witness that he bore the very thorns created by man's original sin and rebellion in the garden so that we might one day wear the crown of life and glory. And we read about that in James 1:2 and Revelation 2:10. So Jesus took this awful crown, took the mockery of human beings. He's the creator of the universe. He's created us. And he accepted to accept that, to be just mocked, to be spit on, to suffer all of that for us. So that one day he took our foolishness, He took our pride. He took our estrangements. And what he did, he submitted to God the Father as a human being for all of us. Because he is the Creator, he can do that, and he did that for all of us. So he just reversed the whole thing. He's the new Adam. He's the last Adam, the Bible tells us. And he's revolutionized the world. And we're going to see that as time progresses when Christ returns, because he will. He promised that. So all of his suffering was not a show. It was our Creator who took upon himself our humanity and experienced it fully. He joined us, as Pastor Johnson says, in the pit of the worst human suffering, depravity, and death. That's what he did. So, you know, when we stop and think of it, this is really costly grace, isn't it? Cost the physical life of the Son of God for each and every one of us. So as we read this, what are we learn? What are we to learn from it? And how does it impact our life today? Because it impacts our life. Each and every one of us, and how we react to this love and how we accept it. And you're here because I know you've accepted it, but it's good to be able to review what that means. In Romans 6 and verse 4, it's a bit small, but it says, "We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life." So Jesus died for us so that we would walk. We died with him. We were resurrected with him. And the purpose was that we walk in the newness of life. So we are not to take this grace for granted. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote a book. It's called The Cost of Discipleship. And he describes the difference between cheap grace and costly grace. And he basically says that cheap grace, he says, is the denial of God's living world, denial of the incarnation of the Word of God. It's the acceptance of this grace, you know, with our heads, if you will, while not making any changes in our daily lives. It's cheap grace. It's good news. I'm saved, but I can continue living as I want to, just as before. But that's not what God wants. We are called to be disciples of Jesus Christ. So he goes on to describe what is costly grace in his book. And I took the quote from Invitation to Theology by Michael Jenkins. "Costly grace is the hidden treasure in the field, for the sake of which people go and sell with joy everything they have. It is the costly pearl for whose price the merchant sells all that he has. It is Christ's sovereignty for the sake of which you tear out an eye if it causes you to stumble. It is the call of Jesus Christ which causes the disciples to leave his net and follow him. Costly grace is the gospel which must be sought again and again, the gift which has to be asked for, the door at which has to be knocked again and again." He says it is costly because it calls us to discipleship. It is grace because it calls us to follow Jesus Christ. It is costly because it costs people their lives. It is grace because it gives them their lives. It is costly because it condemns sin. It is grace because it justifies the sinner. And we're all sinners. Yesterday, I was reading, and maybe you read the article in yesterday's paper where it says that, you know, there's no religion basically that can give us righteousness. You know, so all religions are equal. And he's right. He just ran the wrong conclusion, but he's right, because the only way to have righteousness is a gift of grace by Jesus, by God. And he goes on to say, above all, grace is costly because it was costly to God, because it cost God the life of God's Son. You were bought with a price. And because the gift of God's Son was not too costly for God to give for our lives, God did indeed give him up for us. Costly grace is the incarnation of God. So, this is quite a price when we think about it. We are to walk in newness of life. We have been freed from sin by God, by Jesus, not to serve sin, not to serve sin, but to serve God, to serve Jesus Christ. That's what we've been called to. We are completely forgiven at our core, the core of our beings, not only of our actions, but in our core. We are made new in Christ. And we have been, that has been told to us. And people are already forgiven without knowing it, many of them. But, you know, what does it mean? And I could go a whole sermon on that. But basically, being forgiven, what is the implication for us? Being forgiven, we are to be forgivers. We are to be forgivers. We are to forgive others as we have been forgiven, we are told. And that costs pride. It costs letting go of expectation from other people. It lets go of revenge. It lets go of, we say, God, you take care of it. And we do that not in a revengeful way, because God is a loving God and God will deal with them in a loving way. And he'll correct in a loving way with the purpose of bringing these people, whoever offended us, to a relationship with him. Because we are loved by God, we are to be lovers of God, and we are to be lovers of other people. Just that one phrase, that we are to love God and to love our neighbor as ourselves, says an enormous amount, doesn't it? It just, as human beings, we cannot do this. We grow into it, but God has done that for us. And we trust him and we grow in him. And, you know, one day, when God is finished with us, when his work is complete in our lives at the resurrection, we'll see it. The work is complete, but it's progressive in some ways, in ways. You know, we're going to see one another. And if we were to see one another in the glory that we will be, we would probably maybe think, you know, can this be Terry? Can this be Cecil? Can this be Winston? Can this be Eric? You know, it's such a wonderful being, such a glorified being. And so if we were to see one another in that way, because God tells us we are to do good to one another, especially to the household. We are to do good to all people, especially to the household of God. So if we see one another as God sees us, and the potential that is not evident in our lives right now, but it's a done deal in God, as we continue faithfully in him, you know, we would trust, we would love one another, will grow in love for one another because God transforms our minds. He pours out his love and he gives us the vision of the hope that we just see darkly right now. But we'll listen to one another, we would value one another because of what God is doing. So we can, as God open our minds through, with the help of the God, the Holy Spirit, and as we read scripture about the birth and the life and the death of Jesus and his resurrection, we can pray that God will open our eyes to receive this awesome love which God has, which has been given to us by God. And as we look at this whole universe, we know that God is not a failure. He's created the bigness and the smallness of the universe, which is absolutely fantastic. And God is not going to fail at saving human beings. We know some will reject him, because God will not force anybody into his kingdom. But we can be thankful for the first perfect gift of Jesus Christ, that he has given us the most costly gift of all, himself. Emmanuel, God with us. It's the costliest gift that he could give. So what does he ask of us? He asks us, present yourself as living sacrifices. We're not perfect sacrifices, but Jesus is. But we are to present ourselves knowing that we are accepted by God because of what he has done for us. This is our acceptable and spiritual worship, God tells us. Let us pray. Father, we pause before you at this time. And as we look at Scripture, we see that you are an extremely loving God beyond what we can imagine, that you who are the creator of the whole world, God the Father, you gave us your eternal Son, who sustains the whole of the universe, who entered time and submitted to the barbarity and the viciousness that human beings we can inflict on one another. And you adopted our fallen human nature. You took it on in exchange for the reception of your life that you give to us. Father, we ask that this would not be just theoretical knowledge. We ask that it would not be head knowledge. We ask, Father, that we would be transformed in our whole being with your help to strengthen our faith, to pour your love in our hearts, to live in the transformed life and the new identity that you have given us. Fill us with your passion, the same passion that you have for us, that you have one and for one another in the Trinity. Fill us with that kind of passion for you, for one another, and for all the others who do not know you yet. In humility, knowing that we are sinners, knowing that we do not deserve anything, and knowing that you gave us everything and you have opened our eyes to it right now, in this life, at this time, for your purposes. We glorify you, we thank you. In Jesus' holy and precious name we pray. Amen.